Hello students, welcome to the introduction of product lifecycle management part 4, which is a part of module 1. So my name is Mr. Srinivas Chennai and I am the assistant professor of Department of Mechanical Engineering of Canara Engineering College. So let's first of all look at what are the contents that we are going to discuss in this last part, that is the fourth part in this first module. So first we will be looking at what is product data management and how these data is managed in an organization. And when it comes to product lifecycle management, when a product passes throughout the lifecycle of the product, then a lot of data is being generated. So how these datas are managed in the organization is what we will see. And we will also look at developing a PLM strategy, how a PLM strategy is developed. We have already seen what is strategy, what are the different elements of strategies, and what are the resources needed in order to implement the PLM strategy. So with this background from the third part of the video, we will be understanding what is the development of PLM strategy. And then finally, we will understand how to implement a product data management system. So once we have the necessary or the sufficient data related to a product, how exactly do we manage or how do we implement the product data management systems? So that is what we will discuss in this particular part. The first topic that I would like to discuss here is developing a PLM strategy. Now, when it comes to a strategy, we have already seen what a strategy is. A PLM strategy is a starting point of developing and implementing or improvement plans. This strategy acts as a starting point for developing and implementing or improvement of the plans. Strategy describes the way to achieve objectives, how the resources will be organized or how the resources will be managed and used will be discussed. What are the policies governing the use and the management of resources will be decided in the PLM strategy. Deciding how to organize, manage and use the resources is a key part of the strategy development. So a PLM strategy will be basically company specific. So without knowing a particular organization in detail, it's not possible to say what the strategy should be. So typically a PLM strategy will be developed for a 5-year period. So basically when you are developing a strategy for any organization, it will not be developed for a very short term period, whereas it will be developed for a very long term perspective or usually for a period of 5 years. It will then be reviewed annually. So annually these strategies need to be reviewed, and the strategy should only be changed during the 5-year period for very good reasons. So if the strategy is successful and if your company is growing or the organization is going in the right direction as expected, then it is not necessary to change the strategy of the company. Whereas if it is not going as per the expectations, then you can change the strategies within 5 years based on some of the good reasons that you have. So in case if you have sufficient explanations and reasons to change the strategy, you can definitely change it within 5 years. Often it will take 2 or 3 years for effects of a change of strategy to become evident. So whenever you plan for the future and whenever you plan for a strategy, it will usually take at least 2 or 3 years in order to properly implement that particular strategy. You will not see immediate effects and results when any strategy is implemented or any plan is implemented, whereas it will take at least 2 or 3 years. So by the time 3 years are gone, you will know what exactly your organization is doing, where exactly it is heading towards, and if it is heading towards the right direction as you have decided or as you had predicted in your strategy, then it is fine. You can go on and carry on with that strategy, and you need not do any necessary changes. Whereas if it does not reach the intended goal or it does not move in the intended direction, then it is necessary to change the strategy. Maybe after 2-3 years when everything is properly visible to you. So a PLM strategy is basically a starting point for developing and implementing improvement plans. So whatever improvement plans are there for the future, this strategy acts as a starting point. A PLM strategy helps everybody to move forward along the same road towards the new environment. So when we are saying strategy, we are planning for the future. There is something that is unexpected in the future and we need to plan for that future. So in order to plan for that future, we need to develop a strategy. So there is some new environment which is going to come up in the future, and we are planning to move forward along the same road. All of us are planning, whether it is the top level management or maybe the workers or maybe the managers, whoever it is, everyone is trying to move along the same road towards newer environments. So basically, developing a PLM strategy is a 5-step process. So as you can see here, the basic 5 steps are collecting information, identifying possible strategies, selecting a strategy, communicating the selected strategy, and implementing the strategy. So these are the basic 5 steps of developing a PLM strategy. So we'll try to look at these 5 steps one by one. So the first step in developing a PLM strategy is collecting the information. Now, when you say information, it can be vision, it can be mission, it can be target statements, or it can be customers, it can be resources. You can collect information about different capabilities or maybe information related to the products. So these are some of the informations that are needed to be collected when it comes to information collecting. You need to collect what is the vision of the organization, what is the mission of the organization, what are your targets that you are expecting in the near future, who are your target customers, are you trying to expand your customer base or not, what are the resources that are available with you, what additional resources do you need, do you have the necessary capabilities and the skills and the knowledge base in order to reach that particular target, whether your product is sufficient or you need to diversify your products, what kind of products are to be produced, products should go to what kind of markets. So these are some of the things that you need to these are some of the informations that you need to collect during the information collection stage. So from the outline of a strategy document, it can be seen that a very good understanding of the activities and the resources in product lifecycle is needed. So it is very much necessary to have a very good understanding of the activities and the resources in the product lifecycle to develop a PLM strategy. So this understanding must be based on factual information. So when you say understanding of a PLM strategy, you need to have factual information with you and not on guesses and opinions. You cannot guess something and give your opinions just like that. You need to have factual information. That is why the first step of strategy development involves assembling the information with which the strategy will be developed. So this informations are all these things that I have mentioned here. It includes vision, mission, it includes the targets, customers, innovation, what are the objectives of the organization, details of the resources, capabilities, environment, the strengths and the weaknesses, the opportunities and the threats, what are the strengths of my organization, what are my weaknesses, how do I overcome my weakness, what are the opportunities that I have to change, and what are the threats from my competitors. So all these informations are collected in the information collection stage. You can use various techniques such as brainstorming and process analysis, which uses questionnaires to gather and understand the information describing the current situation. So you can use any technique you want in order to collect the information. You can use questionnaires, or you can do surveys, or you can do some live recording, or you can actually go to the customers and talk, and you can search for some patents, or maybe you can search for some technical documents or journals. You can literally choose any method you want in order to collect information, but everything should be factual in nature. You cannot guess any information, or you cannot give your opinion or on your own, but all these informations need to be collected from the right sources. So you cannot just directly say that I've got the information from somewhere. You need to properly search for these informations from various sources. One of the ways to understand the current situation is to develop a questionnaire. So you can develop a questionnaire and get the people who are supposed to be responsible for individual topics to respond. So you know who are your target audience. So find out who the target audience is and develop a questionnaire and try to send that questionnaire to those people and gather as much information from or response from these people. So another way of gathering information is to carry out an analysis of a typical product by following it through its life cycle and asking questions when appropriate. So this is one more way of doing it. You can carry out an analysis of a typical product. You can take a product itself and you can analyze that product by asking questions. So whenever the product is in the development stage, you can ask some questions to check whether it is being developed in the right manner or not. Or maybe if you have a fully developed product, you can take it to the customers and ask whether they like it or not. So this may give a less theoretical result than the use of questionnaire, but still you will get an idea about how the product may be perceived by the customers. The use of this product data in particular at department boundaries needs to be understood, and whatever data is being obtained or whatever responses are being obtained, it is very much necessary to understand this this particular data. And information repositories also need to be identified. You need to identify information repositories. You need to identify where you will get the data related to products, where you will get data related to the targets, where you will get data related to the markets, where you will get data related to the customers. So all these repositories or areas from where you can search the data also needs to be known. So these are some of the things or activities that happen when it comes to collecting information. So the second step is identifying the possible strategies. You need to identify what are the possible strategies. So these strategies can be business strategies or your competitor strategy, or maybe previous strategies which you had followed earlier. So it can be anything. You need to identify what are the possible strategies. Now the second step, several potential strategies are identified. They are formulated and described in terms of the organization and policies to be applied to the resources. So based on the organization and based on whatever policies you have, you need to describe several potential strategies. You need to identify, you need to formulate, and you need to describe these strategies based on the organization and based on the policies that you set. It is always useful to identify and describe several possible strategies. It's not good to identify just one possible strategy, whereas it is always better to have or identify many such strategies and then come up with the best one. So this will improve the chances of finding the best strategy, since the most obvious strategies are not necessarily the most appropriate. So maybe if there are five or six strategies, not all the strategies might work for you, but you can find out which is the best one which can work for you, and then you can select it. So some candidate strategies for PLM will be apparent from the organization's current and previous strategies, from those of the competitors and other market players. So whatever strategies you are following, it might not be the same as compared to your previous strategies, or it might not be same compared to your competitor strategy. It might be totally different. So you need to understand what is right for you and select the right strategy, or identify the right strategy. In some cases, a candidate strategy will be closely linked to the company's business strategy. So whatever strategy you are developing, it will be closely linked to the business strategies in some of the cases. So whenever some such cases happen, you need to make sure that whatever strategies are being selected are right for your organization. It should not happen in such a way that you select a wrong strategy and then move in the wrong direction and then end up in trouble. So it is very much necessary to select the right strategy. Now, for example, a company may have a strategy of customer focus. So one example is mentioned here as customer focus. One of the strategies of the companies may be customer focus. Because the PLM activity is an important activity, it will probably be expected to adopt this particular strategy. So company management may also set customer focus as an objective for the product development organization. So your top level management might also set this as an objective, not just a strategy, but also as an objective, saying that customer focus is our objective. The product development organization may respond to this objective with a strategy of customer focus and another strategy such as fastest time to market. So whatever product development team is there, they might immediately respond to this objective, saying that if customer focus is your objective, then we will try to develop the products in a very short period of time, and we'll try to bring out the product in a faster in the fastest possible time. So fastest time to market will also be another strategy which can be developed by the product development team. The product development organization may also decide to adopt a strategy to its internal customers within the company. So if you say customer focus, the whole team can think of adopting this strategy even internally for themselves, which can help them in improving their product development times. So this is basically what happens in identifying the possible strategies. It is very much necessary to identify the right strategy and move in the right direction. So once the right strategy is identified, the next step is you need to select the strategy. It is very much necessary to select the identified strategies. So experience comes into picture here. And you need to look at the various strengths of the strategies, various weaknesses, various opportunities and various threats that are available if that particular strategy is being selected. So in the third step of strategy development, potential strategies are tested and the most appropriate strategy is selected and it is given in detail. So whatever strategy are identified in the second step, each and every strategy is tested in the third stage. And once the testing is done, appropriate strategy is selected and it is given in detail. So it will be useful to investigate between three or four alternative strategies. So if you have selected at least three or four strategies, if you go in depth and try to test these strategies, you'll get the differences between all these four strategies. So this should lead to an in-depth understanding of the possible strategies. The strengths and the weakness of a particular strategy often become clear when examining the strengths and weaknesses of other strategies. So if you observe the strengths and weaknesses of your competitor strategy, and strengths and weaknesses of other strategies that you have selected. So whatever strategies you have selected in the or identified in the second step, you can very clearly understand what are its strengths and weaknesses. The analysis of this different strategies is often called a SWOT analysis. The acronym stands for strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats. So different authorities on strategy development use the SWOT acronym in different ways. Often the strengths and weaknesses apply to the organization for which the strategy is being developed. And opportunities and threats are those for the environment. So usually strengths and weaknesses will be for our own use and opportunities and threats will be for the external environment. So what are the opportunities in the market? What are the opportunities with respect to our competitors? What are the threats that are available from the competitors? This comes under the external environment. And what are our strengths? What are our weaknesses? This comes under the internal environment. So the strengths and weaknesses can be those of the present or the future situation, and opportunities and threats those of the current or the future environment. So strengths and weaknesses may also be defined for competitors, and the SWOT analysis for PLM is carried out after identifying several potential strategies. So you need to identify many such strategies and you need to come up with the SWOT analysis. The questions are aimed at finding out which strategies are suitable. You need to ask a lot of questions when it comes to selecting a strategy, basically to find out which strategies are suitable and which of the suitable strategies are most appropriate. So when it comes to this third step of selecting a strategy, it is very much necessary to ask a lot of questions in order to find which strategy is suitable. So when you're going for strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threat analysis, you need to ask a lot of question to understand which is the most suitable and which appropriate strategy can be selected. So some of the questions that can be asked during the selection of strategy is, does this strategy meet the objectives? Will it actually meet the objectives or not? Is it in line with the overall company objectives? Overall objectives are set by the organization. Is it exactly as per that objectives or not? Will it enable us to achieve the mission? Whatever mission we have defined, will it be able to achieve that particular mission? How does it address key issues? Whatever key issues or important points are there for that particular product, will it be able to address it or not? How does it relate to key success factors? So whatever factors we have defined for the success of the product or success of the organization, will it be contributing towards that success factor or not? How will it be possible to measure progress towards specified targets? So whenever we have set a target and we are trying to move towards the target, how are we going to assess or how are we going to measure the progress when we are moving towards the specified targets? What would be the key metrics? What are the key parameters that you need to control or that you need to look after when it comes to product development? How long would it take to implement? So how long will the product development process be taken in order to be implemented? What are the overall costs? So what are the total costs involved? Do we have the financial strength to do this? So is it financially, economically viable to go for this project? Do we have the necessary finances to go for this project or not? What are the benefits to the organization? If we go for this particular strategy, what benefits do we get from implementing this strategy? Do we have the resources to do this? Do we have the necessary resources to adopt this particular strategy or not? Can we find, afford the missing resources? If there are some resources which are missing, if we do not have sufficient expertise, if we do not have sufficient machines, if we do not have sufficient labor, if we do not have sufficient technology to build something or to manufacture something, can we try to afford these missing resources? Can we find these missing resources? Can we hire some new employees? Can we purchase some new equipments? Can we restructure our whole process? These questions also come into picture. Does this strategy play to our strengths? Now, whatever strengths we have identified, will it play according to the strengths or not? Does it address our weakness? So whatever weakness we have, will it address our weaknesses or will it overlook the weaknesses? Does it allow us to take advantages of opportunities? Now, there might be some opportunities from the external environment. Will this strategy give us some opportunity to take advantage of those opportunities? Does it help us to help us against threats? So whatever threat is coming from the external environment, will it be able to help us against this threat? What will be the impact on customer responsiveness? So once a product is sold into the market, how will the customer response? How will it impact the customer response? What would this strategy save time? So if we implement this particular strategy, is it going to save us a lot of time or not? What would be the effect of this strategy on quality? So what kind of quality product are we able to achieve with the implementation of this strategy? What is the effect of this strategy on the quality of the final product? What would be the effect of this strategy on product cost? So what will be the ultimate cost of the product? How will this strategy affect the cost of the final product? What would be the effect of this strategy on the cost of product development and product support? So how effectively can we develop the product using this strategy, and how effectively can we support the product using this particular strategy? So all these various questions, I think I've listed out maybe 15 or 20 questions here, and all these questions need to be addressed when it comes to selecting a particular strategy. It is very much necessary to understand all these aspects before selecting the right strategy. So this is basically what happens in the third step of selecting a strategy. So next, moving on to the fourth step, which is communicating a strategy. So in this fourth step, we need to communicate this particular strategy, and it must be communicated in such a way that it should be understandable by everyone. In the sense, if a strategy needs to be understandable by everyone, it needs to be realistic. If it is unrealistic, if it is ambiguous and questionable, then people will ask a lot of questions and there will be a lot of confusions, and people may not understand what that strategy is. So it must be realistic first of all, so that it can be understood by everyone in the organization. So in the fourth step of the five step strategy development process, you need to communicate this selected strategy to the people who will be affected or involved. Now this strategy must be communicated to each and every person who is getting involved in the product development process and who is getting affected by this. So communication of the strategy is very much essential. So a strategy becomes completely useless unless the people who are going to be involved are fully aware of it. So whoever is working on this project, whether he is a smallest part contributor or a very big contributor, it doesn't matter. Every single person who is a part of this product development process need to be fully aware of what this strategy is. He need to understand what it is and he should be able to implement it. The name given to the strategy must be short. It must be simple that everyone can understand it. So whatever strategy name you're giving, whatever definitions you're giving, so whatever parameters you're explaining there, it should be short, it should be understandable, and it should be able to implement. People should be able to implement it. Okay. So a strategy has to be realistic. It has to be expressed in language that everyone can understand. If there are some languages or some words used which cannot be understood by everyone, then it doesn't make sense in including such statements. So it is very much necessary to use very simple language so that people will very clearly understand what the strategy is. it is important to have general agreement on vocabulary. So as I mentioned, you need to use the right vocabulary before communicating the strategy. So it should be made sure that everyone understands the meaning of the terminology. So before distributing the strategy, you need to test that particular strategy on a few people. By selecting random people from the audience, and if they don't understand it, then you need to make it understandable before communicating it to the to all the people in the organization. So you need to pick people from each department in your organization and test the strategy by giving it to them and checking whether they will understand it or not. If they understand it, well and good. If they do not understand it, then you need to do the necessary changes, and only then you need to circulate the strategy throughout the organizations. So decisions should be made like to whom the strategy needs to be communicated to before starting to communicate it. First, you need to decide to whom you need to communicate this strategy. Of course, you need to communicate it to everyone, but you cannot directly communicate it to someone just like that. You need to go step by step. Strategy should be communicated to everyone involved with PLM. The more they understand it, the more chance it has of being implemented. So more and more the people understand the strategy, the more chances are that it may get implemented. And also it should be made sure that people understand the importance and necessity of the strategy, and should take to and should see that every individual takes it. So it is very much necessary to see that people understand its importance, and they get the right communication about the strategy and all the issues related to it, and they will be able to take or grasp or understand that particular strategy. So this is basically what happens in the fourth step, that is communicating the selected strategy. You need to select the strategy and you need to communicate it effectively. So when it comes to the last step of developing a PLM strategy, it is nothing but implementing the strategy. So once you have selected a strategy and once you have communicated it to everyone, you need to select the right strategy. So or you need to implement the strategy that you have selected. So the PLM strategy report should contain a plan. So whatever report you are generating, strategy report, it should contain a plan showing how the strategy will be implemented over the length of time and the total implementation. Now, if you're thinking of a 5-year plan, a strategy for improving your company for the next 5 years, so 5-year plan should be clearly maintained in the or mentioned in the strategy report, and a more detailed plan should be given for the first year so that people will clearly understand what changes they are going through. The structure for the plan should follow that for the PLM framework, making it easier for managers and others to see how all issues are linked and will be addressed. So a 5-year plan will basically have these many items, starting from startup, management of the initiative, organizational structure of activities, processes, organizational structures, people, information, working methods, information systems, and accompanying actions. So these are the different views in the strategies, and these needs to be planned accordingly, and it should be prepared in a very systematic way with different levels of detail. The first view should be the block diagram, only showing which type of activity will take place each year, as shown in the below table. You can see this table here, which is shown below, and in this block diagram it will show the different types of activities that will take place each year. So it will be needed for people who will participate it and manage the activity. So this kind of a table will be needed by all the people who will participate in this strategy and the development of the organization. So if you observe here, the first year there is a startup, there is a management of initiative, and there are people and there are processes involved. So by looking at this, you can see that people need to change in the first year. There will be some kind of activity that is going to start up in the first year. When it comes to working methods, you can see this working methods here. This working methods is mentioned here for year 2 and year 3. So it means that working methods are going to change from the second year onwards and go up to the third year. So you need to be prepared for this change when it comes to second year and third year. And people need to be aware of all these activities for all the 5 years. So that is why it is shown here. People is completely shaded here for all the 5 years. So accompanying actions, whatever changes happen, there will be some accompanying actions. These actions will happen right from the first year to the fifth year. So maybe an year-wise plan, a detailed plan like this or a report like this need to be given. This is just a sample or a general view of a report. In detailed report needs to be given to all the stakeholders and all the employees working in the organization so that they will have a very clear idea about how this strategy will be implemented in the next 5 years. So this is how a report should be prepared and it should be tried to implement in the organization. So this is basically how a PLM strategy will be developed in an organization using these 5 steps. So the next topic that we are going to discuss is product data management. So how exactly a product data is managed in an organization is what we will discuss here. So first, PDM is the use of softwares and other tools to track and control data related to a particular product. So whenever a product passes through the life cycle, a lot of data will be generated and we need to track and control this particular data. So softwares and other tools are used in order to track this particular data and control the data for a particular product. So this particular software that is being used is called as product data management softwares. So PDM serves as a central knowledge repository for processes and product history. So whatever product is being developed in an organization, it will have a lot of data which is being generated, and this PDM serves as a central knowledge repository. It will act as a central data bank or as a library for obtaining all the details related to the product history. PDM promotes the integration and data exchange among all businesses, business users who interact with the products. So whoever is interacting with the products, each and every business user will be able to get access to this particular data, and we can exchange data among all these users, and it is very easy to access the data and find out what exactly the details are for the product. The central database will also manage metadata, such as the owner of the file and the status of the components. Now it is not just the data that is being accessed by everyone. You will also know who created that particular data, who is the owner of the file, and what is the status of the components, where exactly the product has reached in the organization, what work is going on, and where exactly will it reach after a certain period of time, how much time will it take to come out of the production line, how much time is needed for the designing, how much time is needed for manufacturing. Each and every status of the product will be monitored and controlled when it comes to product data management. The package will control check-in and check-out of product data and manipulate bill of materials. So the moment the product checks in, or the raw material checks in into the manufacturing plant, and the moment when the final product moves out of the manufacturing plant, each and every details will be monitored and it will be controlled, and you can even manipulate the bill of materials. So within PDM, the focus is on managing and tracking the creation or the change and archiving all the data related to the product. So whatever data is created and whatever data continuously changes with respect to time, the focus is managing and tracking all these things and storing these data related to the product. When you say archiving, it means that you're storing that particular data either digitally or maybe in physical books, or when it comes to product lifecycle management, it all happens in a computer system. So digitally storing these particular data related to the product, when it comes to creating new data and changing the new data, is the focus of product data management. The data tracked, stored, or managed usually involves whatever the data is tracked or whatever it is stored or whatever data is managed, it will usually involve all the technical specifications of the product. Whatever technical drawings or whatever technical specifications are generated during the design stage or the process planning stage or the concept design stage or detailed designing stage, each and every technical specifications of the product is recorded. Specifications for manufacture and development. What are the specifications of manufacturing? Which tool needs to be used? Which raw material needs to be used? How many raw materials are to be used? How to fix the raw materials to the machine? How much machining time is needed? Each and every specification related to manufacturing and development also needs to be managed and tracked. The type of materials used, the kind of materials that you will be using for a particular component, what type of material will you be using to manufacture a particular component also needs to be tracked and stored. also very important engineering data such as CAD models, part number, part description, measuring units, cost per piece, or price per piece. This also needs to be stored and managed so that you will have each and every details regarding all the products. Now, if the product is huge, if you're trying to build a huge product, for example, you can take an aeroplane. If you want to build an aeroplane, it will have thousands of parts in it. So each part need to have a CAD model, each part need to have a part number, each part need to have a part description, and you need to mention the cost and price of each part. So that it becomes easy for you to track these parts with the help of part numbers. So engineering data such as all these things need to be continuously tracked and stored so that you can effectively utilize this data in these datas in the future. And drawings and their associated documents. So whatever drawings are available, whatever drawings are generated during the designing stage, and any associated documents related to these drawings also need to be tracked, stored, and managed. So these are some of the things that product data management team will be undergoing. And the final topic for this chapter is implementation of PDM systems. What are the things that you need to look for when you think of implementing of PDM systems? So anyone who is implementing a PDM system is likely to be faced by people who don't want to change the status. So if a person in an organization wants to implement a PDM system, there will be people who do not want to change, who will be resistant to change. So there are lots of people in most companies who will provide all sort of justifications for not doing whatever is proposed. So whenever some good idea is being proposed, there will always be objections from people who do not want to follow whatever is being proposed. So to prepare for such behavior, anyone who wants to implement PDM needs to be well armed with reasons. So if me as a manager, I want to implement PDM in my organization, I need to be ready with all the reasons and all the answers so as to counter the questions that are being asked to me from whoever is opposing these kind of projects. The reasons for implementing a PDM system can be divided into two classes. So whatever reasons are there for implementing PDM systems, it will be divided into two classes. In one of these, the PDM system appears to highlight some of the problems that occur in the product development environment. So in one case, the PDM system will appear to elevate or highlight the problems that occur in the product development environment. And in other cases, it appears proactively and positively. It appears to proactively and positively impact the operations across the product lifecycle. So there are two classes of reasons for implementing PLM. In one case, it will highlight the problems, and in the other case, it will highlight what are the advantages. So the first class of reasons include those in which the PDM system is used to overcome currently existing problems. So if there are any currently existing problems in the organization, the first class of the reasons will include how effectively you can overcome these problems. So many of these reasons are related to rapidly increasing amount of data in the product development environment, and there is a general trend towards product development operations becoming more information sensitive intensive. So whenever a product is being developed in an organization, it will be information intensive. A lot of information will be generated, and a corresponding push to use the information driven process to support overall business activities will be there. So whenever such a lot of information is being developed, it becomes very difficult to handle and manage this particular data. So this is where PDM will help you in order to manage these data effectively. The increased computerization of product development activities leads to increase in the volume and availability of product data. So the more computerization you do, the more computers you use, the more digital equipments you use, the more easy it becomes to increase the volume and the availability of the product data or to manage the product data. So without PDM systems, this information can't be managed effectively. So when such huge amounts of data are being generated, so if you do not use a PDM system, it becomes very difficult to manage this particular data effectively. Among the second class of reasons that you will give in order to implement PDM, they fall in the category of positively impacting operations, such as better use of resources or better access to information, better reuse of design information, better control of engineering changes, a reduction in design cost or reduction in lead times, and improved security of product information. So these are some of the reasons that you can give which will positively impact the operations. So you can say that we can use the resources in a better way, or we can access information in a very very nice way, or in a better way. We can reuse the design information which is already available. We can control the engineering changes in a better way, or we can try to reduce the design cost by reusing the already available data. We can reduce the lead time. Since all data is readily available with us, we can reduce the lead time. We need not redesign everything, whereas we can take the existing design and then we can do the redesigning. And we can also improve the security of the product information. So these are some of the reasons that you can give and try to implement PDM in an organization. So the reasons can be grouped into 11 categories. And each category, most of the reasons can be related both to the resolution of current problems and to the proactive improvement of activities across the product lifecycle. So it can be divided into 11 categories. So first is information management. Provide a single controlled vault for product information. So just one single central database for all the product information. Maintain different views of information structure. So you can maintain the different views for the information structure. You can provide faster access to the data, and you can manage all the configurations of the data. Second is reuse of information. You can make available existing designs for use of new products and reduce duplicate data entry. Next is workflow management, which makes sure the most appropriate design process is followed, and improve distribution of work to engineers, and ensure release procedures are followed. So you can make sure that appropriate design process and improved distribution process is distributed to the engineers. And the next one is engineering change management, where you can speed up the distribution, review and approval of engineering changes, and provide status information on engineering changes. So whatever changes happen in the drawings, or maybe the design, these changes can be effectively and quickly distributed, reviewed and approved. The next group will be overall business performance improvement. You can improve the product quality and reduce the cost of the product. Resolution of business problems. You can try to reduce the scrap, you can try to reduce the number of errors and reduce the product liability costs. So next is functional performance improvement. You can increase engineering productivity by already having access to all the data readily. You can try to increase your productivity and develop better cost estimates. And the next one is better management of product development activities. You can manage the product development activities in a better way. You can improve the project coordination. You can increase the reliability of the product development schedules, and you can provide high quality management information. The next category is automation of product development activities. You can automate the sign-off process. You can automate the transfer of data between applications. So instead of manually or physically transferring the data from one place to another place, you can think of automating these data from one application to the other application. The 10th category is information system effectiveness improvement. So you can integrate islands of automation. So different areas of automation you can integrate together and link the databases together. So database of one organization or one department can be interlinked with the other department, so that everything is transparent and everything is visible. And you can remove unnecessary systems. Systems which are unnecessary and which need not be used can be removed. And the last category is infrastructure for effective product development. You can build an infrastructure to support product development practices and computer systems, and to distribute data, documents and messages electronically. So you can think of developing your infrastructure for effectively communicating the product data, or effectively distributing the data or the documents or the messages, and it all happens electronically. So using computer systems, you can think of electronically distributing all the data across the lifecycle and across all the different departments in the organization. So these are the 11 groups or 11 categories in which you can think of implementing the PDM systems. So this is all about product data management, and by this we come to the conclusion of the first module of product lifecycle management. Thank you.